Okay, so off we go. So here's where we were last time. We were talking about vector fields. We just kind of barely got started on vector fields. The big idea is that it's basically one of these pictures right here. So at every point in the domain, there is an associated vector that I like to call the field vector for that point. Okay. All right. So I think we saw at least one of these examples, if I remember correctly. The first one, anyway, is a pretty simple one. Look at this. The field vector is a constant. That means at every point in the whole domain, the corresponding field vector is always exactly the same. It's always 2, 1, right? And that is, again, I emphasize, for every point, for every x, y, you get that same field vector, 2, 1. So pretty easy picture. Worth pointing out that this is not what you would expect necessarily. Like if you're thinking too much in terms of graphs, right? And keep in mind, this picture is not a graph. It's just not. It's a completely different construction, right? And we're kind of accustomed to thinking, oh, constant means like, I don't know, like horizontal or something like that. Not even a little bit. Right? So, make sure to, again, keep separated in your mind these different kinds of constructions, and don't assume that how calculus looks in one of these contexts will carry over to how it looks in the others, because they just don't. Okay, the next one. Let's talk about this one right here. I claim it ends up looking kind of like this. How did I make that connection? Well, keep in mind, for any given point, I'll do it with purple. For any given point, x, the field vector, it would seem, is, oh my gosh, that looks exactly like the point, doesn't it? But this is a vector field, so you got to keep in mind, what goes in is a point, but what comes out is a vector. You have to think of it as a vector, not as a point. So if I want to say, yeah, but come on, look, x, y is x, y, right? And then what that means is this field vector is the position vector for that point. And the position vector for that purple point you draw like that, right? Tail at the origin, head at the point. Okay. So this is the correct vector that we associate to that point. Now, but that's not how we draw vector fields, right? We have a very strict rule. When you draw vector fields, you represent at the point in question the corresponding field vector with its tail at the point. Here we drew the tail at the origin because that's how we were thinking at the time. Right? So, right vector, wrong drawing. I have to draw that vector here. Right? That, then, is how we represent the field vector, x, y, at the point, x, y. And what you're going to notice about this is, okay, so that means that this particular vector field has the feature that all the field vectors are pointing away from the origin. And the farther you are away from the origin, the greater the magnitude of those field vectors. And that is how you interpret, sort of all together, that this looks like that. Everybody follow there? Good, clever argument. Okay, next example. Let's see, I can zoom in so we can see better. Might as well do that. How are we going to make sense out of that? Now, different situation. I look at the field vector on the right. I don't exactly recognize it. It's certainly not equal to the input point's position vector. But you do see there's an x and a y in there. It's got a lot in common with the position vector for the point. And pretty quickly you'll persuade yourself that this vector has the same magnitude as that. And also, and I'm just noticing here, but this field vector dot the position vector is zero. So the field vector here is orthogonal to the position vector and has the same magnitude. So let me color code what we've just thought through there. So at this point, x, y, there's the position vector, which now again, just for sort of geometric convenience, I'm going to draw again like that. There's the position, same vector, it's weird location, right? But my field vector here has the same magnitude but is orthogonal to that purple position vector. And right off the bat then, that tells me that this is either that or this. Those are the only two vectors that have the same magnitude and are orthogonal, perpendicular to that position vector. So how do I know which one of these it is? How do I decide between those? How do you plug in a point, right? Pick, I don't know, 1 comma 0 and see what you get and draw the... And you'll just notice that, in fact, it's the of these two choices, it's this one right here that is the correct answer. Okay, is everybody on board with that?
So would you suggest plugging, like having arbitrary points first and then drawing?
Every vector field is a little bit different. There is no single method that it's just always going to work. So I'm, as usual, I'm showing you tools for the toolbox, right? And I don't have a particularly suggested, you know, always go through the following checklist. So you're gonna look at every vector field that you see and think, okay, what tricks have I seen before and what seems to apply best here? Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
So just to clarify, the field vector being orthogonal to the position vector, that's just for like this specific one, not like all.
Yes. Vectors. Yeah. That's a peculiarity of this exact specific vector field. Right. Okay, now the very last observation I want to make about this now let me get rid of that position vector because I don't need it anymore. Check this out. You can see it right here in the picture. The field vector is literally a quarter turn counterclockwise rotation of the original position vector. That's kind of wild. Right? And that's another way that, now again, in some circumstances, it might be helpful, right? That you can recognize. I wouldn't have to go through, you know, once I make this realization that is this relationship, I don't have to go through this argument about orthogonality and, you know, magnitudes and stuff like that. So how would you go about recognizing that on your own? This is going to be largely an exercise for y'all to think through on your own. But what you can do, different ways of saying this, write this, observe that it's a linear transformation. I mean, it is, right? And write down the matrix that this corresponds to. And it's just a matter of just taking your formula and seeing what makes that matrix multiplication work. And once you have the matrix, then you can ask, hey, what are those column vectors, right? And just draw what those column vectors are on your picture. And what you'll notice is that both of the column vectors are 90 degrees counterclockwise rotations of the standard basis vectors. And that's how you know that this is a rotation in that sense. But anyway, good linear algebra to think through. If you didn't quite follow what I just said there, come to my office hours. We'll talk about it. I'll be very happy to help. But make sure that you're comfortable with that sort of linear algebra take on this stuff. Okay. All right. Move it along. Okay. Next example. Oh, what happened there? There we go. Okay. This is a surprisingly relevant vector field. Doesn't look particularly important. Got a cubic in the denominator, for crying out loud. That seems weird, right? So here's the better way to write this as I see it. It's better to write it like this. I almost never write it like that. It's just not a particularly useful way to think about it. So what I like about what I have circled now, you're going to notice first that this is a unit vector. Wherever you might happen to be, unit vector. And furthermore, parallel to the position vector, it's literally a scalar multiple of the position vector, which means, God bless America, this still works. Yeah, okay, good. This is always pointing outward away from the origin, right? So scale it, still going to be pointing radially, right? Radially outward away from the origin. So the mere fact that that you see x over the magnitude of x tells you this is a radial vector field. And the other thing you're going to notice is that this is what we call inverse square. I think that's pretty easy to motivate. You just look at the algebra there. So this vector field, what I have, you know, this, again, hard to make sense out of it from that point of view, but if you look at it like so, radial inverse square. And here's what's interesting about radial inverse square vector fields, and by the way, just terminologically, sometimes people will just say inverse square, because radial inverse square is the only inverse square vector field that comes up that much. So gravitational fields, like I have drawn here, are radial inverse square vector fields. So these are massively important in physics. It's hugely important in physics. And you might be thinking to yourself, okay, yeah, but I'm in engineering. I have no interest in being an astronaut. Why do I need to understand gravitational fields? At the surface of the Earth, gravitational fields are constants. It's pretty easy to understand the constant. Down. End of story, right? So why should you, as engineers, be interested in this? And that is because it is also exactly the structure of electric fields. And electric fields are absolutely relevant to engineers. Right? Y'all all need to understand electric fields. So my own little personal take on this, in case that might be useful in your futures, is the fact that both of these fields have the exact same structure. Different constants, different units. Yeah, fine. But mathematically, they have the exact same structure is an opportunity. And I have personally cashed in on this opportunity a tremendous amount. This has been hugely helpful to me. And that is, if you're trying to understand electric fields, right, it's kind of hard to... Wait, electric field, that's just a... I've never seen one before. I've never felt one before, right? I've never seen an electric charge before. It's very hard to relate to, right? But other than constants, it's exactly the same as a gravitational field. And I feel that every day, right? As do we all. I know what mass looks like. I see it all the time. I know what gravity feels like. We feel it all the time. So I think this is a really neat observation. And by the way, we're going to talk more about this later on when we get to chapter 7. The fact that there is such a strong relationship between these is going to be very convenient for us. Okay, gradients. This is just an innocent observation. There's no deep water on this little observation here. We've talked about gradients before. And the only thing, and we already know that they point uphill on the graph. Yawn, right? Old news. The only observation here is that a gradient, in fact, is a vector field. We didn't think of it that way when we were talking about gradients because we were only interested in one point at a time. But check it out. Here's a gradient, right, that comes from that particular function right there. And check it out. At a point x, comma y, here's the field vector. Vector field. Right, and you can observe as well that that vector field, which you can plot, again, it's kind of, you know, radial outward like that. That is, as promised, pointing uphill on the graph. You can imagine anywhere you might be on the graph of this function, x squared plus y squared, this is what the graph looks like. Wherever you might happen to be, down here on the map representing where you are on the graph, which way do you go to go uphill? Well, outward, as per the gradient. So, just an observation. Gradients are vector fields. Okay. All right. Terminology. This is a point where I see things a little differently from a lot of other people. I'm going to start with the terminology that makes most sense to me. Call me crazy, but if you take the gradient of something, I think it's reasonable to call the result the gradient. Nobody's shocked by this. Likewise, I consider to be kind of equally natural in the spirit of derivative, antiderivative, if you kind of turn that around backwards and say, hey, I've got a vector field, I want to know what is the function whose gradient is that vector field, I think antigradient. Perfectly analogous to antiderivative. Right? Everybody okay with that? Okay. So that's a terminology I prefer. I really like this term antigradient. You're going to hear me use the term antigradient through most of this course. It's just natural, right? That said, it's not the most common term. The most common term is potential function. A lot harder to see why that's natural, right? So here's why. Just a fact of physics. Very often, certainly from the point, if you're thinking about gravity, this is a relationship between potential energy and force. So gravity is a nice example. Let's think about the gravity. gravity down, right? So the force here, gravity, is down. Now let's think about potential energy. Y'all remember potential energy from way back? Whatever you took physics, that is, maybe high school. There's more potential energy at higher altitudes because when something is up high, it has the potential that when you drop it to have a lot of energy at lower altitudes. So more potential up high, less potential down low. In fact, potential energy is just a scalar multiple of altitude. It's Z. It's constant times Z. Okay, what do you get when you take the gradient? Right? Imagine we take the, so we have potential energy and you take the gradient, is the gradient of Z, of constant times Z, is the gradient downward? Nope. If you have constant times Z, the gradient's upward. The force is downward. So we're off by a minus sign. So that minus sign right there is really important. Right? It's tempting to say that potential energy is the antigradient of force, but it isn't. It's the negative. So now there is a take here, and I get it. I'm all in favor of the observation that okay, look, yeah, but the thing that is the antigradient, it's very closely related to potential energy, sure. Yeah, it's very closely related. It's off only by a minus sign, right? But I feel like when you call it the potential function, you're kind of blurring, you're concealing that minus sign. And I think that's really awkward. I think that creates potential for oopses. And again, you know, it's just a sign error, but sign errors make a bridge fall down. So this is, I consider to be a problem. You're going to hear the term potential function a lot. So heads up, be aware of that minus sign. And in this class, you're going to hear me say the term antigradient. And when you hear me say antigradient, that means what everybody else means when they say potential function. Is that cool? Everybody happy? All right. Alrighty. Okay, so we've talked about various forces. We've talked about gravitational fields, electric fields, gravity again, thinking about the gradient being the gravitational field downward and all that. Don't forget, there is this other totally different physical metaphor for vector fields, and that is fluid flows. Right, and we actually did mention that last time, briefly, but I made the observation that one of the vector fields we saw looked like a stirred pot. Right. This is the other one of the other anyway big metaphors for vector fields, and lots of different kinds of fluid flows in three dimensions. Look at this. All those are different kinds of fluid flows. Perfectly natural. Very important things to make sure that you understand, right? We need to understand how air flows and et cetera, other things, how they flow. Now, those are three-dimensional examples. They're also two-dimensional examples. And it's weird to think about a two-dimensional fluid, but ultimately it really kind of does make sense in a lot of ways. The one I like to talk about is animal migrations. It seems a little wrong to talk about animals as being a fluid, right? They seem like they're discrete, individual, well-defined things, right? This isn't Terminator 2, right? Did I just date myself? That's because way back to the 90s. How is it reasonable to talk about animals as being a fluid? And I'm going to remind you that water. Now, everybody's comfortable with the idea that water is a fluid, right? But what is water made up out of? It's a bunch of little particles. It's a bunch of little particles which, you know, as they sort of flow, particles that are near each other tend to flow kind of along with each other. All right? Well, if you have a gigantic flock of, you know, I don't know what kind of birds or locusts or, you know, any of these, you know, flying type animals, great big giant, there's millions of them, and they all flow kind of together as they go. They really do behave a lot like a fluid. It's a little bit of a weird thought, but it's actually ultimately a pretty natural way to model, you know, how a herd or a flock or a whatever the word is for whatever species, how it, you know, sort of moves around as a vector field. Okay. All right, so here's a calculation I want to do. This is going to have a very important punchline, but for the moment, let me just describe this as a calculation we could do, sort of a question we can ask and an answer we can come to. And so notice we start with a vector field representing the velocity of a fluid. This is a pretty natural way to use a vector field to represent a fluid flow. Again, as the fluid is flowing at any given point, the fluid has a velocity at that point. And that velocity can be the field vector. Okay, so given that, and given, suppose we have some piece of area like this, small flat area. Now, by the way, I need to know how this area is sort of sitting in space. Let's use my left hand as an example. My left hand has a certain amount of area, sure, but this is a different piece of area from that, which is a different piece of area. I mean, how it's sitting in space might matter, right? So I'm going to describe how my hand is sitting in space by way of a normal vector, a vector perpendicular to that surface. And notice, if you know which direction that normal vector is pointing, then you know how your area is sort of arranged. We say oriented in space. Okay. All right, so the normal vector, we typically use a unit vector. So in here is a unit vector, tells us how that area is oriented. Okay, so the big question. We've got a fluid, we've got an area. What's the flow rate? So by flow rate, what I mean is volume per unit time of fluid going through that surface. Okay, now, a lot of people look at the term flow rate and get confused because they're like, wait a minute, I thought that's what the velocity is. Isn't the velocity telling you the rate that the fluid is flowing? What do we call that, the flow rate? Definitely not. Velocity, distance per unit time, right? Feet per second, for example. Flow rate means volume per unit time. We've got this surface sitting here, and as the fluid flows, as it flows, we can talk about how many cubic inches per second, how much volume per unit time is passing through our surface. So it's not distance per unit time, it's volume per unit time. Right? And so just as an example of this, you can talk about a river, you can talk about how fast the water's flowing, feet per second. But when you talk about the flow rate of the river, it's how many cubic feet per second, or cubic meters, or sometimes, you know, thousands of cubic meters per second. that are actually coming out of the river. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay, so that's what we're interested in, is how do we compute this flow rate? And again, our fluid velocity is like that. Okay, so there's one little preliminary observation I'm going to make before I get into the calculation, and that is that if we have, you know, again, we've got this water that's kind of flowing through this surface, and I'm going to talk about a particular piece of water, let's say it's right there. And if I give it a small amount of time, if I give it delta T, a little small amount of time, think of it as delta T seconds, right? Going with this as its velocity for that amount of time, I can ask how much, what is the displacement of that little particle of water in time delta T? And that displacement, I'm going to represent, actually I'm going to zoom in so I can see this better. There we go. So our displacement, let's see here. Let me do this in dark blue. That right there. And how do you understand displacement in terms of velocity and time? Well, displacement is velocity times time. Right, so that vector, which is a little bit easier seen over here where there's less going on and sort of less in the way, that displacement is just velocity, the field vector, times time, delta T. Is that cool? Is everybody happy with that? Okay. Well, it's kind of all over but the shouting at this point. It's just a couple of little quickie observations we have to make. So let's see, starting with... Let's see, I tell you what, I'm going to clean up my mess. Let me get rid of a lot of this. I need to keep that. Okay, let me get rid of... we'll do it like that. Okay, so how do I compute this amount of volume? I'm in... wrong mode. Okay. The amount of volume that passes through per unit time. We'll get to the time factor in a minute, but let's just think about this volume. That volume, height times the area of the base. Old high school geometry formula. Height being that right there. That's the height. And let's see, the area of the base, that right there. Height, everybody remember this old formula from high school? Okay. Okie dokie. Well, let's talk about that height now. The height relates to our displacement vector. We've already talked about our displacement vector there. I claim that height is just the normal component of the displacement vector. Keep in mind the normal, this in normal vector we already have, right? That's just telling us the direction perpendicular to our surface. So, you know, looking at the picture, there you go. And wait a second, the displacement vector, we just got through talking about that. That displacement vector is delta T times F. And boom, we have our calculation mostly done. Now, not quite. There's one little detail that we do have. I keep erasing this thing. I don't want to erase. One little detail that we do need to fix. We have just computed volume in a given amount of time, but I want volume per unit time, so I want to kind of divide that up to there, if you will, and what's left over, dv dt, volume per unit time, is going to be just what's sort of left over on the right here, and that's that. This expression here, F dot N times A, that calculates our flow rate for us. Everybody happy? It's a good little exercise in geometry and components and, you know, stuff like that. All right. Okay, so natural question, compact little answer. turns out this is going to be an object that's one of the main things we're going to talk about in chapter 7. This thing deserves a name and a notation. So the name is flux, and the notation is the capital Greek letter phi. The phi that we see in spherical coordinates is lowercase, so just to avoid confusion, capital phi for flux. Okay, how are we doing? Everybody's good. Okay, now, question.
Yeah, sure. You said that you suppose that the vector function f is velocity, is it always going to be
No, that's a great question. So in this, and that was going to be the next thing I was going to say, actually. So in this question, we were presuming that we were representing the fluid flow by way of the velocity, that being the field vector. That is not always going to be the case. Yeah. When it is, then flux computes volume per unit time. Right. So if you have velocity, then what you compute with flux is volume per unit time. Now here's another different setup that's also really useful, arguably more useful, depending on the this and the that. But in this new setup, we're going to have, this is a little weird when you first see it, but we're going to use as our vector field to represent the fluid flow not the velocity. We're going to have density times velocity. And that seems strange, right? A little weird. Why would I multiply density times velocity? The punchline is going to be that flux, in this case, computes not volume per unit time, but mass per unit time. Or in general, if your density isn't mass per unit volume, if your density is some sort of other measure of quantity per unit volume, then this would be whatever that quantity is per unit time. Right. Now let's talk about why we'd be interested in that. Let's go back to the locusts. Right. We've got a swarm of locusts flying around, and I can talk about how fast the locusts are flying. Sure. And I have an open window in my house. And here they come, right? The locusts are going into the window of my house. And oh my gosh, I need to compute the flow rate of locusts in through my window into my house. Am I interested in the volume of locusts per unit time? Probably not so much. What I'm interested in is the quantity, right? So this is why it makes sense to let your vector field be density times velocity. It's not because it's immediately obvious that that's what you'd want to do. Not at all. It's not immediately obvious at all. But I sure like this conclusion of being able to get a handle on quantity per unit time of fluid, whatever the nature of the quantity might be. In the case of my silly example, it would be count, number of locusts flying into my house. Okay. All right. Now, this is something I want y'all to work out on your own. I think it's a lovely little exercise. Here's the good news. It's almost exactly the same as what I have here. Y'all are going to shamelessly copy what I've got here, right? All you've got to do, just a little bit different, instead of looking at volume, I wanted to be in pencil mode. Instead of looking at volume, because we were previously looking at volume per unit time, but now I'm interested in mass, so this should be delta M instead of delta V. What do I have to do to delta V to turn it into delta M? Well, I just have to multiply by density. That carries along all the way down. The rest of the calculation, very, very similar. Whoops. My bad. A little too far. Carries all the way down to here. And then when I, and this is the little detail I want you all to think through for yourselves. F times delta T is not D by itself. It's D times density. So good little exercise. Think through why F delta T is displacement times density. Basically, the point is because the F is not just velocity anymore. Now there's this extra factor of density, and that's that extra factor of density that just absorbs right into there. So think it through, right? Think through all the details, but that's the broad strokes of how that goes. And again, reminder, if you get stuck on any of that, if you have any questions on any of that, come to office hours. Happy to talk about it. We'll help you out. Okay. Unfortunately, mostly for me, a lot of what's on this page we just don't have time for. Not time in the class, but not time really in the course. So the example at the bottom of this page, I am going to put a big X through it in just a minute. But I do want to talk about, and I think this is a reasonable thing to make sure you understand, why we would care about such a thing. And it addresses the following question, or the following observation. Sometimes you can't talk about the velocity of the fluid. And I know that sounds weird. It seems like if you have a fluid flowing, you just look at a particular point and you just see, well, look, the particles at that point are going to be moving with some velocity, for crying out loud. Why can't we just call that the velocity? I mean, what's the holdup here? Right? Well, there's some weird fluids out there. And all the fluids that I've talked about up to now are, you know, water-like, in the sense that if you have two little pieces of water near each other, they tend to flow with each other pretty much. If you have a swarm of locusts, yeah, they tend to go with. The two locusts are going like this and cross over. They smack into each other, and they locusts cannot pass through each other, right? They just can't. Okay, most fluids we think of as not the fluid cannot pass through itself, but there is one that can. And probably others that can. So the easiest one to think of for me, though, is light. So if I have a light bulb right there shooting out photons every which way, that's making a flow of a fluid of photons. Okay? And if I have a light bulb over here, again, shooting out photons every which way, that makes a flow of a fluid of photons. Say that three times fast. Now let's think about what's going on at that point, though. Right. At that point, well, I mean, a trillionth of a second after I turn these light bulbs on, there are photons passing through this point. And at that point, there are some green photons that are going that way, and there are some blue photons that are going that way. And so I repeat the question, what is the velocity at this point? Should it be this one or that one, or do I like add them or something? What do you? It's not clear what you should do here, right? Okay. So that's the problem we want to consider, and there's a temptation to throw up your hands and say, well, then I guess we can't. We're just, you know, dead in the water. We can't possibly make sense out of this in the way we did on the previous page. But in fact, we can. In fact, we can use the result on the previous page, right? Turn it around backwards, and it answers the question for us. So what we did on the previous page is we assumed we knew the vector field, and we used that to address the question of, hey, what's the flow rate? And what we're going to do now is, again, just kind of turning that around backwards, I'm going to say, look, I can empirically measure the flow rate, right? I can take a classroom like this. There's photons flying around every which way. There's multiple light sources. At this point, there's multiple different velocities of photons all at this one point. What field should I use to describe at this point? Well, I would just take my, you know, take a little piece of area. Somehow, I don't know how the engineering of this would work, but somehow empirically measure the flow through this piece of surface. Do that for all possible surfaces, and then just ask, what is the vector field that makes this equation work?
And for reasons that I don't want to go into right now, it turns out, yes, this will always be possible. You can always find such a vector field, and that is the vector field that describes that fluid flow. So anyway, kind of a neat idea, and I just wanted to let y'all know that that is something that you can do. And with that said, this really interesting example that I would love to have time to talk about. We don't have time, and y'all are absolved of all responsibility for this example. You do not have to look at this example. This example will not be on a test or anything. So you don't have to. That said, it is very cool. I hope you might be interested in taking a look. If you want to hear about it, come to office hours. I'll be very happy to talk about it. But again, not part of the course at this point. Okay. Okay, and then a quickie observation here. this is pretty straightforward. This is actually really a very modest observation. But back to using velocity to representing fluid flow. And I like to think about this in the context of water. I don't know, I find that most convenient. But you can use air or any kind of fluid you like, whatever. If you drop some sort of a particle into the fluid, And we want to get rid of other annoying things, like I don't want to have to worry about buoyancy or gravity dropping it down to the bottom of the pool or stuff like that, right? So let's imagine that it's perfectly buoyant. It's just exactly, it's not going to float and it's not going to drop. It's just, it has the same density as the water. Okay. If the water is flowing, I claim the particle is going to go wherever the water makes it go. Right? Does that make sense? Pretty reasonable, right? You've probably seen examples of this of a sort. Namely, if you look at a creek in the woods or something, and fall and the leaves drop down, when the leaf touches the water, it starts to flow right in exactly the same direction that the water's flowing. Because it kind of has to, right? It doesn't have a little outboard motor on the leaf and bzzz upstream like a salmon. No, not at all, right? That's silly. Of course it goes exactly where the water is. What else could it possibly do? So that is really where this big nasty differential equation comes from. That's all this is saying. oh, I skipped one thing here. That particle makes a path. Position is a function of time. Let's call that x of t. That's a parametric curve. And that noted back to here, the velocity of the particle, x prime, that's the velocity of the particle, okay, is the velocity of the fluid. That's most of it right here. Velocity of the particle is the velocity of the fluid. Again, of course it is. And then just one little specific clarification. Look, the fluid, there's a fluid all over the place. The fluid's going with one velocity over there and maybe a totally different velocity there. When you say the velocity of the particle is the velocity of the fluid, which velocity of the fluid? At what point are we interested in the velocity of the fluid? Well, I mean, wherever the particle is, of course. And so the velocity of the fluid, we need to specify at wherever the particle actually is, namely at the point x of t. Okay, so we make that observation, and then we make one last little innocent observation, which I've gotten my color coding backwards here, but the velocity of the fluid is what the vector field is. That was our original premise, is that we're using the velocity to create the vector field. And then with all of that noted, here's our differential equation. Our differential equation is this right there. And if you want to know, if you want to solve this differential equation, by the way, how to solve a differential equation, that's not what we're doing in this course. That's Math 353 for those of you who are going on to 353. But these can be solved. And whatever you get is just going to tell you what the path of the particles are.
that are in that fluid. We call these flow lines.
Which I think is a pretty natural term. Easy
exercise to, and this is a healthy exercise, you should totally do this, but if you look at this vector field right there and ask what are the flow lines of this vector field, well, this is the vector field F. And again, we're looking at this equation, and the claim being made here is that cosine t sine t is a solution. Well, just plug it in. No big deal. You're going to have to take a derivative on the left side of the equation. You're going to have to take these formulas for x and y and plug those into what the vector field F does to compute the right side, and what you will find is that the equation works. So sure enough, that is a solution to this vector field. Details, again, for you all to check algebraically, do that algebra, take you 45 seconds, no big deal, right? But make sure you're comfortable with how that works. And by the way, this is as it should be. Y'all remember this vector field. This vector field is the stirred pot, right? It's counterclockwise rotating fluid. So, yeah, no surprise that you get circular paths, right? Well, of course you do. That's sort of obvious from the picture. Does everybody believe that? It seemed pretty natural. Okay, last little quickie observation, and then we're on to the next thing. So we've talked about how vector fields can be used to represent forces. And we've talked about how vector fields can be used to represent fluids. Something that I've observed as I've been teaching multivariable calculus for the last many, many, many years is that there's a strong tendency for students to decide that they like one of these metaphors better than the other, and to just kind of go all in on that one metaphor and say, I tell you what, you know, when I see a vector field in this class, I'm thinking fluid. Or perhaps, everybody's different, right? Some people might say, hey, whenever I see a vector field, I'm thinking forces, this whole fluid business, I don't really get that, what's going on there, right? So people tend to pick one. And I just want to give you some advance notice, you can't do that. We are going to do some stuff in Chapter 7 that absolutely critically relies on understanding the vector field as forces. There's no getting around it, right? And we are going to do some other stuff in Chapter 7 that absolutely relies on thinking of the vector fields as representing fluids. So you got to really spend some time thinking about both of these points of view. And again, make sure to have a conscious distinction in your mind of the one versus the other, right? So they are different physical stories, but they both describe vector fields. Okay. All right, weird section coming in here. And let's see, by the way, are we pretty short on time here? Okay, I'm going to do one little quick thing here in 3.4. Real quick, just an FYI, this is an odd topic to introduce right here. We're not at all close to actually doing anything with any of these ideas I'm about to present here in 3.4. The reason we're doing it now, aside from the fact that, well, because the book is because this is an opportunity to plant some thoughts in your mind. Some thoughts that take a little bit of chewing and a little bit of digesting, and it's good to get that done early so that when we get to this stuff later on, you'll already kind of have somewhat of a sense of what it is. So, y'all remember gradient? I'm going to point out you could rewrite gradient like this. It seems a little strange, but surely the interpretation you would make of this would be that, right? And having written it like this, well, now I'm going to make the observation, well, that means I can make sense out of this symbol all by itself. That symbol is just weird, kind of it's like it's a vector, but these things that are in it are not numbers, so a little bit of symbolic nonsense again. Right? So remember, we saw some symbolic nonsense when we were talking about cross products, and we wrote it as a symbolic determinant that was not a determinant of an actual matrix, right? But it notationally very convenient, and it's handy, and you can totally get away with it, and it's totally fine. So we're going to be making big use of this thing. This thing that allows us to compute gradient is called the del operator, and it turns out that it's a very handy object for defining various things, not just gradient. Make sure you do not call this the gradient operator. It is going to be much more than that. The term gradient means this specifically. This is the del operator. Y'all have a great weekend. See you later. Okay, 2 seconds. Let me just, attendance first.